Good morning. She's playing it on the piano. I believe it's page number 36. It's a song of exaltation, a chorus of exaltation, that the whole earth should praise the name of Jesus. Let's stand. Let the house of God, the people of God, and the church of God sing the exaltation of our Savior. Page 36. Do your best now. He is exalted.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this morning and the privilege you give us to come together. Thank you, Lord, that we can come as a body of believers and exalt your holy name. Lord, thank you for the privilege that through your Son, we can come directly to the throne of grace and cry, Abba, Father. And Lord, I pray that you fill us with your Spirit today and that we would be challenged to be in perfect communion as your children with you. That, Father, there would be no sin that would be between us and you. And Father, if there is sin in our heart, Father, may we claim 1 John 1:9 and confess our sins. For your word says that you are faithful and just to forgive us of all of our iniquities. Thank you, Lord, for that promise. And thank you, Lord, for the sweet fellowship that we can have. It is through your Son's precious name. In his name we pray. Amen. Let us turn around and greet one another.
Bless you. You may be seated. So good to see you this morning and just to gather together today in the house of God as the people of God. Thank you so much for our guests that are here. I see some faces that I've seen once or twice before, some new faces that are visiting with us today. If you're visiting with us, in the pew in front of you is a connection card. If you'd be so kind as to reach out, grab that card, fill it out, put it in the offering plate when the plate goes by. That will give us a record of your attendance, how you heard about us, who invited you. If you're ashamed of who invited you, just say a little birdie in the sky, something like that, whatever it will be. But if you passed the bus bench, if you got us online, if you came to the Christmas lights, fall festival, all kinds of things that God is using for people to find Plantation Baptist Church. It's a busy time of year for Plantation Baptist Church as we're moving into or through the month of January. And of course, our sights are set on next Sunday being our Revival Sunday. And Revival begins at Plantation Baptist. It goes Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. I've got the information there in the bulletin for you. The preacher will preach two different messages at 8:30 and 11. I don't mean he's going to preach two messages at each time. I don't want to scare you to death. But 8:30 will be a message. 11 will be a different. In case you have to work Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and you're unable to make the revival services, you can at least get three services on Sunday. It takes about five or six services to really settle us for revival. And so I would encourage you to make your plans to be at all of them on Monday through Wednesday. You see, we have a dinner at 5:30. Those tickets are available at the welcome desk. There'll be nursery every night. There'll be a children's service every night. The youth department will stay in the auditorium. And it's just going to be a revival filled with music and with preaching. The team is bringing four students with them, and so they play violins, they play instruments, they sing, and I know that the music will prepare our hearts for the preaching of the Word of God. I would encourage you to invite a guest to revival on Monday or even at any of the services. If you know somebody who's not a believer, this is the time to invite them. When God's people begin to be revived, you find the evidence of that by the salvation of souls. Is there anybody here that was saved during a revival service? You were saved during one, two, we had two folks here, three, four, and five in the back. Now we're raising them. Well, and I know four out of those five pretty good, and they really did get saved because they were scoundrels before that, and they needed to be saved. So praise the Lord for what God has done in their heart. Just kidding about that. There's a 24-hour prayer chain set up at the welcome desk. Every member and regular attender of Plantation Baptist, if you call yourself a Christian, you need to sign up and take a link of in our prayer chain. A link will last you 15 minutes. In those 15 minutes, there's a sheet out there, and it gives you about 10 things to pray for. Pastor, I've never prayed for 15 minutes in my life. Well, this will enable you to do that. It's a simple way for you to do that. And so it'll outline it for you. Take a link in that chain, and we want to bathe our revival in prayer so that we have God's power. Do not forget that. Stop by the desk and sign up if you can as well. That's really the agenda for us. There's all kinds of announcements that are in the bulletin that take us from this Tuesday of a Ladies in Prayer all the way through February 12th. February 12th is important because that's my birthday. So did you notice in the bulletin? I'm having a birthday party on that Sunday night. We're going bowling, and I'm inviting the whole church to come bowling with Pastor on his birthday on February 12th. I love to bowl. A couple years ago, they lied to me in this church and told me they were going bowling, and they had a party for me over here. This year, we're going bowling because I'm running my own party. All right, so that's just how it's going. We're going bowling. $5, you bowl for 2 hours, gives you your shoes, all the food you want to eat there as far as the pizza and the drinks and so on. And it goes from 5 to 7. I'll get more information to you about that. But Pastor, I don't bowl. That's fine. Just pay your $5, come sit there, enjoy all that secondhand smoke, and fellowship with us. But that's on there, all kinds of things that are moving forward. It's a busy day today because of announcements, and I want to ask the guys to cue up that video for the Mission to Haiti. Mission to Haiti is having an evening of vision banquet to help raise funds for the schooling of the Haitian children, helping with those churches down there on February 10th. And the tickets are for sale at the welcome desk. Many of us support children through this organization that enables them to be blessed down there. And I want you to watch this 90-second video, and I trust it'll stir your heart to at least a place of interest where you'll stop by the welcome desk. Go ahead, Randy, this time.
Thank you.
you're looking to make a difference in the world, one of the great opportunities we have at our church is to make a difference through Mission to Haiti. How many currently support a child through Mission to Haiti organization? Many of us, we've done it for many years. I would encourage you to stop by the desk, find out about their evening of vision. I wanted also to remind you that today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. And there's movements all across the nation in recognition of that God is the giver of all life. And we put a brochure in the bulletin today for a local organization called Hope Women's Center. These are wonderful people that are doing the work of God in the gospel work of God, also in the life-saving business. They've got an announcement there, maybe a plea for help, for an encouraging and equipping help from men and from women. And I want you to at least read that, see if God would stir your heart. If you'd like more information on that, we have one of their board members who's a member of our church. And I can put you in touch with them if you would just let me know. Our church has been richly blessed by God's people, and two of those people are Ron and Doris Giles. And I'm going to ask them to come at this time. God has given them a ministry that involves marriages, and twice a year, they lead a marriage class entitled Discovering God's Vision for Your Marriage. That marriage class is going to begin again on February 9th, and I want them to come and just to introduce it and to say a word about that. But before they do that, I wonder how many people have been to their class? You've been to the marriage class already. Would you stand just a moment? Just stand if you've been there. It doesn't mean your marriage is on the rocks. It just means you went to the class, okay? Stand up for that. And we've got some folks in there. Look around, and if somebody's close to you when it's done, you can just be seated. And just ask them. I went through the class with Beverly, a couple of the lessons there before we even introduced it. And I'm telling you, man, if you're married, whether you've been married a month or you've been married 100 years, this thing will absolutely bless you. It will bring a vision and a unity and a thrill and an excitement to your marriage. Listen to what they have to say. And just listen if the Spirit of God says in your heart, hey, this is for you. Would you please welcome Ron and Doris Giles?
Good morning, church family. And those wonderful people that sing to us every Sunday morning. So thank you. Thank you, Pastor, for your support for this particular ministry. It's very much appreciated. And on a number of occasions, and even this morning, the pastor has suggested that every married couple should take this class. And why did he say that? Well, there's a very good reason. God continues to be glorified in each of the couples that have taken this class. It's very important to understand how Satan is attacking us these days, and I believe that this will strengthen you. So, this class is for every marriage, as the pastor just said. Every stage, good or bad, happy or sad. So, this particular book has been written by a couple called Clint and Penny Bragg of Inverse Ministries. And we've studied under them. The pastor, as he said, has read it as well. And this is a booklet which will be given to every couple who comes. So this is something that we follow. So what will you learn in the class through this book? Well, some of the topics that are going to be covered are, first of all, your personal relationship with God. It's very important to understand that that's the key to a good marriage, is each individual's personal relationship with God. But when you come together as a couple, then there are certain things that God has taught us in his word. So the second one then is God's standards. So these are promises and directions that are found in his word. And we need to understand what they mean for our marriage. We'll learn about how to seek God as a couple in a marriage. The Bible teaches a lot about how to seek God as an individual, but it also talks about how to seek God as a couple. It's very important. The power of prayer in your marriage, praying together in your marriage. That's a very important one. We'll teach you that. Nurturing trust in your relationship. Trust, a very important word. One of the best ones we teach is how to have conversations with your spouse that will affect change and growth. Conversations, not communication. We don't We shouldn't speak to each other in 140 characters on a little electronic gadget. Conversations, that's a very important one. Courageous ones at that. Another one is how to agree when you disagree. How many couples disagree on things? Huh? Okay. How to agree when you disagree. That's a wonderful evening of teaching that night, and we'll show you how to deal with that. And finally, what we do is we take all of these classes, all of these tools that we've taught you, and we show you how you can put them into action for the rest of your marriage. One of the things that we do is that we gather all of the folks that we've taken in our previous classes, and we have a date night. We haven't had this one. Sorry, folks, for those that stood up. We'll have it in a couple of months, hopefully. But this is our fourth class coming up. We've already gone through three classes. There's over 30 couples have taken the class. And hopefully, if you saw the folks that stood there, you can go and ask them what that would mean or what it's meant to them and how it's changed and strengthened a marriage. So really, I just want to finish with this. Strong, stable, God-fearing, holy marriages are a window for the world to see God's glory and his love for us. They're a window to the world. They're a long-lasting legacy for our family and our friends. Weak or broken marriages can affect more than just the husband and wife. They stretch quite a bit. So what does your marriage speak to your family, to your friends? And what legacy are you leaving behind? So Doris and I saw this need for our marriage 7 years ago. And we sought a study that would help us understand God's precepts in understanding marriage the way God would see it. And so we sought this book out. We sought this couple. We've gone through the training with them. We partner with them. But we've also had, as I said, three full classes on this. So we're beginning to see how God has helped us, obviously, but helping the folks who have taken this class. So as we implemented this particular portion of it, there's many other books, but this one in particular, it basically saved our relationship and has really brought us to a place of peace and joy. And it's something I would love you folks to have as well. So I'm going to ask Doris just to give us a little bit of information on the mechanics and the administration side of it. Thank you.
So we start February the 9th. It's for 10 Thursday evenings from 7 until 8:30. But we must know that you're going to sign up. We only have room for no more than 12 couples because we like to keep it intimate. And I hear from a lot of people that say, oh, I don't get home till 6, 6:30. Please just bring your supper with you. Mm-hmm. Pick up a sandwich. Come where it's very relaxed. Just take that time to make sure that you're there. It's one thing, I've always heard that Baptists eat a lot, but this is one class I promise you that we are not going to ask you to bring food, snacks for others, okay? We just want to make sure that you are there. So please sign up this morning if you can. If you can't sign up this morning at the welcome desk with us, then please call the office and they'll put you in contact with us. So put it on your calendar, please, February 9th. Thursdays, there's 10 weeks, and we hope to see you there.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
It's really great. Every time we run the class, we hear wonderful testimonies about that, and so I'd encourage you, whether you have a strong marriage now or you need help in your marriage, You ought to consider, Pastor, what if I can't make all 10 services? That's fine. We need you to make about 8 of them at least. It is a commitment. It is a commitment, but it's one that's worthy of our investment. Next Sunday will be Brother Jeff Smith's first Sunday as a staff member at Plantation Baptist. He's out of town on a vacation. Brother Rod is filling in for him. The choir's coming to sing one of my favorite songs. I'm kind of old-fashioned, I guess. I don't know. You probably noticed that by now. I love this old song. It's entitled My Tribute. God bless you, choir, as you sing. Amen. Thank you, choir. Page number 492 follows that song very well. Songwriter wrote a song of thanksgiving and of praise, a song that he was expressing his desire that he should have been saved a lot earlier in life. The first verse begins, "Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified." Now he's come to the truth. Now he's been saved. He's so grateful for the mercy and the grace that was free where he first saw it at Calvary. This is a great song for the church. It's one that just we enjoy singing because it shows the love of God. Let's stand. Let's lift our voice. 492 at Calvary.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing that it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary.
Job. Let's dismiss our children up through the fifth grade to junior church. Thank you for bringing the children. The staff will get them at the door. They'll have their class while they're doing that. You notice the flower display down here is in representation of Lloyd Cavanaugh. Lloyd was the brother of Audrey Ebanks, and Lloyd went home to be with the Lord. We had his service yesterday, and then prior to that service, I got a call that our dear brother, Brother Junie Scott, Junie and Edith Scott. Brother Junie went home to be with the Lord this past week. And so we have his service this coming Saturday. It's in the bulletin. The viewing is at 10 o'clock. The service will be at 11 o'clock. Then there'll be a burial and so on and so forth. And so I would encourage you to pray for the Scott family. Pray for Edith. She's not doing well, as you can only imagine. And they need our comfort and our prayers. All right, let's pray this time. We'll ask God's blessing on our service. Heavenly Father God, the hymn writer wrote that song with wonderful joy and confidence and love in his heart. I love that line. Now I've given to Jesus everything, and I own him as my matchless king. So afraid is humanity to give the Lord everything. But the songwriter said, now that I've given to him everything, oh, I see how wonderful he is.
I see the love of God that brought the plan of salvation down through the man of salvation. God, I pray that that would stir our hearts today. The message today does not need to be lengthy, but it does need to have your power on it. And I sense you're in our building today. I sense from the very song that we began to sing, as we exalted the Lord, we sense your presence. We know it in our hearts. We know it in our church. I pray for power today. God, as the message is personal, it's very personal to the individual believer. And I pray that it would be appropriated in our hearts. Thank you for all that we've heard. Thank you for all the announcements. Thank you for all the ministry that is going on. And God, I just pray that you would further that in our hearts. Now is the time when we bring your tithe. And we bring offerings of love. Bless this offering, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated as we continue our worship by the bringing the tithe and offering. If you are a guest today, if you'll be so kind as to put that card in our plate, listen as Morgan and Linda sing our offertory, Jesus, Friend of Sinners.
Jesus, Friend of Sinners, we have strayed so far away. We cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, Friend of Sinners, the truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around but never looking up, I'm so double-minded. A blank eye saint with 30 hands and a heart divided. Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. Yeah. Jesus, Friend of Sinners, the one who's writing in the sand, made the righteous turn away and the stones fall from their hands. And help us to remember that we are all the least of these. Let the memory of your mercy bring your people to their knees. Nobody knows what we're for, only what we're against when we judge the wounded. What if we put our signs crossed over the lines in love like you did? Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. You are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. You are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. You are good. Your love endures forever. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours.
Thank you, ladies. Powerful words to that song. Break our hearts for what breaks yours. I wonder if you were here today and you were brought to the gospel because of the life of someone you knew. Somebody influenced you. You saw Christ in somebody before you received them. Is there anyone here? There you go. That's what that song's all about. That we would not be a stumbling block, pointing our fingers, but that we would always be aware of people needing the Lord. Like, if you would please, to take your Bibles, and once again, would you go back to the book of Ephesians? I know we were there at the end of 2016. We've not been back since then, especially since Christmas and the new year. But I want you to make your way, if you would, please, back to the fourth chapter of the book of Ephesians. When I was preaching through this book and hitting those five walks about our lives, I skipped a verse purposely because I wanted to preach it on the Sunday before revival. I actually wrote on my calendar this message sometime back in the month of November because God had stirred it so definitely in my spirit and laid it on my heart. And I knew I would be preaching throughout January sermons that I hoped would prepare us for revival. I want you to understand with all of my heart, God's people need revival. You need revival. I need you to see it as important to your life. I need you to see it as important to your walk with the Lord. I need you to see it as important as you grow in the Lord, not dismissive of it. The person out there who thinks I don't need revival, you especially need revival. And it's a sweet, sensitive, sanctified time where we set aside all distractions that we can, and we concentrate on God's work in our lives. Yesterday, as any day when we have a funeral is a long day, for me personally, for my wife, for the staff, and for many of the folks that were here serving. And so my wife is no different than your wife, men. At the end of a long day, she does not want to cook a meal. She would rather go out to eat. And I understand that. I appreciate that. And so we got home, and I already knew what was coming. Normally, she'll ask me in just the most submitted, sweet, sensitive voice, "Dear head, what would you like to have for dinner tonight? It's your choice, anything you want." We made eye contact, which I won't do now. And I read right between them eyes, "Man, you're taking me out." So we grabbed the kids and went out, and we were sitting there eating dinner, and I noticed that there was a party in front over there to the side of us, and there were people standing everywhere, and I didn't quite grasp what was going on until my son nudged me, and he said, "Did you see that?" "Did I see what?" He said, "Look at that woman's purse."
I thought, oh God, protect my son from that. I don't want him to like purses. I said, what are you talking about? He said, look at that woman's purse. And so I look over there, and this woman had a plastic see-through purse. He said, if she loses that purse, Dad, she's going to lose thousands of dollars. Well, what are you talking about? He said, look in that thing. He said, you see what's in there? And so now he's got my attention. Now I'm looking at purses and trying to figure out what's going on. And so there was this mother. And what it was there was a birthday party for about kids ages to, let's say, 12 to 15. And there must have been 20, 25 of them. And they had their own little section, and there was really only one way in and one way out. And this mother stood there. And every time a kid would show up, the mother would go like this. And the kid would kind of step back, and the mother would go like this. And the kid would go, oh. And he reached into his pocket, and he grabbed his cell phone. And that mother would not let any one of those kids go to that party with their cell phone. And so inside that purse, she had about 30 to 35 cell phones. And I looked at the table, and they were sitting across from one another, going all the way down, and they were actually talking to one another. They had smiles on their face. Their heads weren't bent over. They weren't like this, you know. They were having a conversation. I thought, what a great mother to make sure that her kid had a balanced life. And I immediately thought about that would make a great illustration for revival. And so basically what I'm asking is I'm asking for your cell phone today. The men are going to come, and we've got offering plates, and they're going to collect them. Just kidding. But revival doesn't just happen. You gotta want it. If you don't want revival, you won't have revival. What is revival? Revival is when the Spirit of God renews your spirit, draws you close to Him, gives you a fresh vision of God, gives you a love for God, gives you a vision for the distraction of the world. It puts a longing and a desire in your heart to have God's power and peace upon your life, to pray, to grow in Him, to have your heart broken, as the girls are saying, for what breaks His heart. We need revival. And I've been preaching messages, hopefully getting you prepared to come next week and hear the evangelist. The evangelist is going to preach tremendously different than me. He has a different gift than I have. I'm the pastor and the teacher. My responsibility is to feed you on a weekly basis. The evangelist's responsibility is to treat you to a dinner out. Now, if you eat out every night of the week, it can be unhealthy, right? Especially if you eat the supersized number 8 at McDonald's every night. It can be unhealthy. In your own personal life, nobody eats out every night of the week. You're not sustained in your life by eating out. You're sustained in your life by the meals you get in your home. Well, that's kind of what church is. The evangelist is going to come, and he's going to herald, and he's going to thunder, and he's going to preach, and you're just going to soak it in, and I'm going to soak it in, and it's going to be like we are out at your favorite restaurant and eating God's word. But you're sustained on a weekly basis in your life by the nutrition or the meal that your pastor feeds you. So the pastor and teacher has a responsibility, but the evangelist has a responsibility in your life as well. Covet it, understand it, see your need for it. When I was preaching through the book of Ephesians, I got down to chapter number 4. I got to verse number 30 in my study, and God smote my heart. And I want to read this verse to you today, and I want to take it as my text. And there was an admonition here from the Apostle Paul to the church at Ephesus and their responsibility when it came to the Holy Spirit of God. Verse number 30, I'd like you to read it out loud with me, please, when I begin. Here we go, 1, 2, 3. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. If you love the Holy Spirit of God, Would you say amen? About 1950, something happened in churches like ours. In 1950, there was a movement sweeping our nation from, I'll call the Pentecostal movement. You might be Pentecostal here. Just stay with me. The Pentecostal and the charismatic movement brought to the forefront of ministry the Holy Spirit of God. And what they did, in my estimation, and we can talk about this later, what they did was they kind of got a little bit of out of balance. I'm going to ask you a question, and you need to get this right in your thinking. If you're afraid, don't say it out loud. How many gods are there? One God. One God. But inside that one God, there are three, anybody know the next word? Persons. It's called the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. There are not three gods. They are one God. Well, Pastor, how can they be one God and be three persons? Because they're God and we're not. It's not very hard to understand this. Brother Malcolm is beginning to be my main focus of illustration at my messages. Brother Malcolm, how many men are you? You're one man, right? God knows the world could not use two of you. You were born a son. You became a father. You're also a grandfather. So you're one man who operates as a son who buried his dad. His mom is still alive. He operates as a father and his two children. And then he operates as a grandfather. Each office or each person acts independently. That's why they make bumper stickers called, if I'd have known grandchildren were this much fun, I would have had them first. Okay? So there's one God, but there's three persons. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. What happened in about 1950 is there was an exaltation of one over the other. Remember, the Lord Jesus thought it not robbery to be equal with God, because he is God. So in this exaltation of the Holy Spirit of God, they began to pull out of the scriptures things that the Holy Spirit of God enabled throughout the book of Acts. Tongues was a big one. Healing was another one. Prophecy was another one. And so there was the exaltation of the Spirit of God, which led to outbursts, cries, people speaking in Babel, sometimes people even falling on the ground barking like dogs, people going into laughing fits. This isn't all these churches, and I'm not saying all that is wrong. I'm just saying there was a time when this exaltation happened. Now, I don't know if you've noticed a little bit about the Baptists, but we're kind of stiff people. And what happened was, as that movement began to spread, it kind of freaked out the Baptist. And so we didn't know how to handle preaching of the Holy Spirit of God. And so therefore, since we didn't know how to handle it, we really stopped preaching about the Holy Spirit. And in doing that, we got out of balance. Because I promise you, the Holy Spirit of God is God. And he's so important in your life. And he deserves, man, he deserves the praise and worship of God's people. And Paul, writing to the church at Ephesus, he wrote to them about the love of God. He wrote to them about the love of God being in their heart. But he also wanted them to understand the ministry of the Holy Spirit of God.
And man, I'll tell you, when you read the scriptures, listen to some of the things the Holy Spirit of God does for God's child. He indwells God's child. That means if you call yourself a Christian, the Holy Spirit of God lives within you. If that's true about you, say amen. If the Holy Spirit of God is not in you, the Bible says you do not belong to God. The Holy Spirit of God is like an engagement ring that God has given to his people. And when the bridegroom comes and raptures us out, he's not looking for obedient people per se. He's not looking for working people per se. He's looking for people that have the engagement ring on or the indwelling of the Spirit of God. So when the Lord Jesus came into my heart, man, I was indwelt by the Spirit of God. And the Bible says that my habitation or my body becomes the habitation of God. The Bible says that I'm the temple of the living God. Let me tell you something. If you don't have the Holy Spirit indwelling you, you're going to hell.
That's right, amen.
Do you not now think we ought to worship the Holy Spirit of God?
Amen.
He imparts gifts to God's people. He teaches God's people. He gives us access to the throne of grace. He prays, man. He intercedes for us. He produces fruit in our life. He gives us power over sin. How great is it to know victory over our sin? The only reason you can know victory over your sin is because the Holy Spirit of God lives in you. And the Apostle Paul wanted God's people to worship and adore and love and respect the Holy Spirit of God. And there's an action he did not want them to do against the Spirit of God. And that was found in verse number 30. And the second word of that is, and say it out loud, please, grieve. Now, I found three actions that can be committed against the Holy Spirit of God. One of them can be committed only by the unsaved person. And the Bible says that the unsaved person has the ability to resist the Holy Spirit of God. Pastor, what would they resist? They would resist the conviction of God upon their heart. They would resist the drawing of them to the Savior. They would resist the regeneration that the Holy Spirit is. So let me just give you an example. See if you identify with this. If you're in this room and you have ever felt a pull inside of your soul, especially at the invitation time or while the preaching has been going on, and you have felt conviction of your sin, or you have felt somehow like the Spirit of God wants you to receive Christ or give your heart to Christ. If you've ever felt that pricking and you have within your body and within your mind said, no, I'm not going to do that, that's resisting the Spirit of God. Now, praise God that our God is a God of second chances. Praise God that our God is relentless in his approach to us. I mean, after he's offered us the gospel one time and we resisted the Holy Spirit, really and truthfully, the Holy Spirit would be justified in just walking away. But I'm glad he didn't walk away from me. I'm glad he was patient and long-suffering with me. Have you resisted the Holy Spirit of God? The other way, another action the Bible talks about, I'll preach about this tonight, is the quenching of the Spirit of God. Now, the quenching of the Spirit of God is something churches do. And I don't ever want it to be said about Plantation Baptist Church that we have quenched the Spirit of God. Holy Spirit of God, may you ever be welcome at Plantation Baptist Church. The word grieve is a personal word. He's talking to you, sir, you, ma'am, to me, Tom Hunter. And he's talking to the individual child of God. And the word grieve is really and truthfully, it's a word that knows the height of love, but the depth of pain and sorrow. It's a love word. To be able to grieve, the word means to cause pain or sorrow. Some of the Bible scholars said that it would go along with agony, the kind of agony that the Lord Jesus faced in the garden, gut-wrenching, blood-sweating, agony that just tears you up inside. Now, Paul says to the Christian, I don't want you to grieve or cause pain or sorrow or agony to the Holy Spirit of God. The reason the word has balance between pain and between love is this. You cannot grieve someone who does not love you. It would be in a husband and wife relationship when one spouse causes pain to the other, maybe through an affair, maybe through words, maybe through rejection, and you have invested your heart in love, and that wound comes in against and pierces that love, and it causes grief. If there's no love toward that person, there can be no grieving toward that person. And so what the apostle is telling God's people is he's telling you this. Not only does God the Father love you, and not only does God the Son love you, but God the Holy Spirit loves you. If that blesses you, say amen. Amen. And because he loves you so much, you have the ability to hurt him. You have the ability to cause him pain. You have the ability to cause him sorrow. You have the ability to grieve him. And the Apostle Paul put a tagline at the end of that verse to kind of help us get a good understanding of the love of the Holy Spirit of God. Look, if you would, at verse number 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are, say that word, sealed unto the day of redemption. Sealed under the day of redemption. So here's what happens. When you got saved, you understand that God loved you and he sent Jesus. Jesus loved you and he went to the cross. The Holy Spirit loves you. He evidences that by sealing you. This is why the doctrine of eternal security is so important in the Word of God. This is why it is not simple to believe that you can lose salvation. I want to say a statement, and I want you to hang with me till the very end. Pastor, do you believe that I can lose my salvation? Don't freak out, but I would answer yes. I believe that you can lose your salvation. I do not believe that you can lose God's salvation. Help me, Pastor. Fine. If you're trying to save yourself by good works, if you're trying to save yourself by being righteous, if you're trying to save yourself by water baptism, if you're trying to save yourself by joining the church, if you're trying to save yourself, my friend, you're going to lose that salvation. But you will never, ever, 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 ever lose God's salvation through the Holy Spirit of God. And God's people said, I firmly 100% believe in eternal security, would vehemently oppose any doctrinal error against eternal security. But you better be saved by the right person, and that's by the Lord Jesus and his Spirit. That's right. And so the Spirit of God comes into you, he indwells you, and then he seals you unto the day of redemption. What does that mean, Pastor? That means that he keeps you. That means that he protects you. It's a security for you. You can never, ever, once the Spirit of God has indwelt you, he will never leave you. You can never shake him out. He can never be drawn out. You can never sin enough for him to leave. And he can protect you from this world. He can protect you from the allures of Satan or the attack of Satan. And so it's a secure position to know that it is the Spirit of God that seals me. Because I know you find this hard to believe, but I have sinned once after I've been saved.
You don't believe that, do you? Because I sin like once every day or more. Can you imagine if every time you sinned, you lost your salvation? Can you imagine every time you had an evil thought that God would strip the salvation he gave you? Can you imagine every time you were unfaithful that God would strip that from you? Can you imagine every time you messed up that God would strip it? And so when the enemy comes and says to God, yeah, did you see what Tom did? He calls himself a Christian. Look what he just did. And God says, I know, and that sin needs to be forgiven. But Tom is eternally sealed and secured by my Spirit, and he can never be lost. The Spirit of God secures us. The Spirit of God provides ownership in that sealing. He owns us. He provides authority in our lives. He brings us to a likeness of God. And so Paul says to the church, to the individual believer, with who the Holy Spirit of God is, and with how much he loves you and how much he has given himself to you, he has put himself in a position where you, based on his love, have the ability to grieve him. And Paul said to God's people, I don't want you to cause pain to the Holy Spirit of God. Now, you know how I'm going to close this message. Pastor, how can I, as a Christian, cause pain or grieve the Holy Spirit of God? How can I cause pain or grieve the Holy Spirit of God? Well, I think there's a few ways. I'll give them to you, write them down. I think the number one way you can grieve the Holy Spirit of God is by ignoring him. Ignoring him. Here's the Holy Spirit of God, who is God. He's the third person in the Trinity. Here's the Holy Spirit of God who has indwelt you and sealed you. Here's the Holy Spirit of God that has the ability or has the responsibility to gift you, direct you, teach you, impart, intercede for you and all of these things. Here's the Spirit of God who's faithful to convict us. Here's the Spirit of God who's faithful to lead us. Here's the Spirit of God that is active in our life, directing us for God's glory, protecting us from the sin, leading us in the way of righteousness, leading us in the will of God, and the Spirit of God speaking to our spirit, and then for us to just flat ignore the voice of God. Nobody likes to be ignored. Nobody likes to be shunned. Nobody likes to be dismissed, even the Holy Spirit of God. Now, I need to ask you a question, and unless you've ever experienced it, you don't know it. Have you ever felt or heard the voice of the Spirit of God inside your spirit? If so, say amen. So when the Spirit of God pricks and convicts and leads and guides, and if I ignore the voice of the Spirit of God, it's grieving to him. If I ignore the call of the Spirit of God, if I ignore the conviction of the Spirit of God, it grieves him. I think refusing to be filled with the Spirit grieves him. The Spirit of God is available and waiting to totally direct and lead and control in your life. The Spirit of God is that which knows the will, is he who knows the will of God. The Spirit of God is the muscle of God. The Spirit of God is the power of God. And that Holy Spirit of God wants to control our lives for God's glory and for our good. And if I refuse to be filled with the Spirit of God on a daily basis and try to live my life according to my own will, I think that grieves the Holy Spirit of God by ignoring him, by refusing him. And then Paul laid out some of our behavior here. Would you look at verse number 20 of chapter number 4? This is a comparison against those that have learned Christ as opposed to those who are not saved. You remember this falls in the text of walking not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind in verse number 17. And so here's the admonition to the believer in verse number 24 to put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Now here's a description. Wherefore putting away, say it class. Lying. So So, Christian, would you look at your pastor? Are you living in a lie right now? Have you told a lie? Is there a part of your life that is organized around a lie? Are you lying to everyone and you know it? The Holy Spirit of God says, when God's people lie, it hurts me, pains me, it grieves me. Verse number 25, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Verse 26, be ye angry and, say that please, sin not. So, child of God, are you here today so angry that you're to the point of hatred? Are you here so wrapped up with anger that you can't even think straight? Are you here angry at your boss, angry at life, angry at God, angry at your spouse? I mean, you're just filled with anger. The Bible says there is righteous anger, but then there's also unrighteous anger. And when God's people allow anger to control them and not the Holy Spirit of God, it causes grief to the Holy Spirit. Verse number 27, neither give place to the, say it class, the devil. So when God's people open the door for the devil, it grieves the Holy Spirit of God. By the way, it's the Holy Spirit of God that keeps you from spending an eternity in hell. So is there some way in your life you've given place to the devil? Are you involved in something you shouldn't? Are you looking at something you shouldn't? Are you tolerating something you shouldn't? Are you in a relationship you shouldn't be and you just somehow cracked open the door? That's giving place. Are you looking at something? It's not horrible, but it's just cracked open. Are you trying things that you know in the Spirit of God is screaming within you, but you just kind of have given a little bit of place, an opportunity for the enemy? I'll tell you this, Christian. You open the door to the enemy, he's coming through it. He's coming through it. And the Holy Spirit of God within you is saying, why would you do this? Why would you do this? The Father loves you. The Son died for you. I have sealed you. I'm willing to lead you in a path and a direction for the glory of God to fill you with God. Why would you open the door even that little bit to give place to the enemy? Verse 28, let him that stole steal no more. Let him be hardworking. Verse 29, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying. Verse 31, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Those things grieve the Holy Spirit of God. But be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. This was something that the Apostle Paul knew was very important for the individual believer at the life of Ephesus. And this is something that I believe is very important for the individual believer of our church. So I'm asking you this question. Are you grieving the Holy Spirit of God in your life? The only reason you can grieve him is because he loves you. He cares for you. Am I grieving him through ignoring, through refusing, or through my behavior? Or have I submitted myself to the Holy Spirit of God for him to control and lead and guide me? I got news for you. The Holy Spirit of God is just that. He is holy. Amen? You got to see him as that. He's the Holy Spirit of God. He's going to be grieved because he loves you so much. Revival is coming around the corner. I don't want you to enter in revival in a position of grieving the Holy Spirit of God. I want you to enter in revival in a position where I'm submitted to the Spirit of God, whatever he has for my life. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father God, one God, three persons. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He is mighty God. Mentioned in verse 2 of the Bible. The indweller, the sealer of mankind. It is the Holy Spirit of God that brings eternal security to our lives. I 100% believe in the doctrine of eternal security. Man is trying to save himself in other ways other than the gospel. That salvation will be lost. But Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And the man that believes upon him shall never be lost. And then the Spirit of God leads and guides and directs and protects and intercedes and gives gifts and teaches, and he loves us. The word grief is a word that can only find possibility within the atmosphere of love, man. You can't hurt anybody that deep if they don't love you. I want God's people to know how much God loves them, how much he loves us. We're not perfect, but we've been perfected by you, Lord. When I sin, man, the Spirit of God screams out within my spirit, Tom, what are you doing, man? Why'd you say that, think that, look at that, do that? Why would you treat those people that way? Tom, that wasn't the truth. Oh, man, he just lights me up. And I'm so glad you're patient and kind and long-suffering and forgiving. So many times I'll ignore the voice of the Spirit of God or try to live my life not filled with the Spirit of God or my behavior. But truth be told, I want my life to be pleasing to you, Lord. And I want it to be pleasing to the Holy Spirit. I want you to have your way and will in our lives. There are some people here today, God, they're not Christians, but they know full well what I said when they felt or heard the voice of the Spirit within them, and they've resisted the Spirit of God. They need to humble themselves, and they need to receive Christ. And God's people need to look at their life and see, am I hurting? Am I grieving? Am I causing pain to the Holy Spirit of God? And make some changes. Have your way in our invitation. In Jesus' name, amen. Our song of invitation is page number 591. Have thine own way. The Spirit of God speak to you, Christian. The Spirit of God reveal a position with you in the Holy Spirit, something that you need to deal with. I would beg you to come forward today and deal with it at the altar. If you're here today and you're not been a Christian, but you know that pricking of the Spirit of God, don't resist the Spirit of God. That's God showing how much he loves you, cares about you, and desires to save you. Humble yourself to that. Oh, my friend, the songwriter said, I've given to Jesus everything. And he was so glad about that in his life. I pray, Spirit of God, that you'd move in our midst. Let's stand, 591, verse number 1. Men of God, be here. You come as God leads you.
Hold me and my Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence humbly I bow.
I told you that the service would be very personal to the individual believer, so I would ask it this time. Just simply ask the Spirit of God, Spirit of God, is there anything in my life that's grieving you? Is there anything in my life, God, that's grieving the Holy Spirit? If so, would you reveal it to me? Oh, it's frightening to be honest with God, because God is perfect and he searches the depth of our heart. But allow him to do that. Allow him. We're going to sing verse number 3. Would you just say, Spirit of God, is there anything in my life that's grieving you? If so, would you bring it to my attention? Then you base your decision off of that. Lift your voice, verse number 3.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray.
Our song to go to Sunday school is found on page 601. So fitting for the message is Yes, Lord, Yes. We have coming far today, Mark and Donna Barber. I'm so excited to have them. They've been saying for weeks now they were going to come, and they have a desire to unite membership with Plantation Baptist Church. I believe based off a transfer of letter from Like Faith or another Baptist church, but God has moved in their heart. And they love the Lord, and they're excited to be part of our church. If you rejoice with the Barbers, say amen. And we have a custom here. When anyone joins the church, we have them stand down here, come by, shake their hand, hug their neck, and love on them, and tell them we rejoice to do that. I would encourage you at the end of the service on your way to Sunday school to come by and to greet them. Look at the page, if you would. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes. I'll trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me with my whole heart, I'll agree. And my answer will be, yes, Lord. Lift your voice. God bless you. Enjoy your class. See you tonight.
I say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I say yes, Lord, yes. I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I agree. And my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
You are dismissed for Sunday school.